Frankly, I don't think we would need additional resources to accommodate a statutory raise of the age of criminal responsibility. I think we could accommodate it wouldn't create more cases in the court system. It would move certain cases from one court to another court. So, you know, we have flexibility in reassigning judges from one court to another court. We have flexibility in reassigning court staff, court officers, court clerks, and the like from one court to another court. If you combine that with the 25 additional family court judgeships that we have now, and the fact that arrests of 16 and 17-year-olds, you know, are much lower than they were a few years ago, we feel that we could accommodate this change, which again would not be more cases, it would be moving cases from one court to another. We feel we can accommodate that with what we have.
Is it not true that when you took the last budget cut that you lost close to 2,000 employees across the spectrum?
Yes.
But we're
dealing with the it's the same number of cases. Raise the age doesn't necessarily reduce the number of cases, although it can. It could lead to more diversion of cases out of the courts and 16 and 17-year-olds going into programs, rather than having their cases go through the court system. But we're not expanding the number of cases. We're merely moving them from one court to another. And we feel a court that the cases that are better served and can be better handled in the family court than in the criminal courts. So given that, and given our flexibility to move judges around and our flexibility to move court employees around, since this wouldn't be more cases for the court system, it would be the same number of cases or maybe even fewer cases, that we could accommodate that.
Okay, my time's going to run out, but the crux of the question for me is, we've given you 20 new judges, but do you have the court support staff for those 20 judges in the numbers, given the cuts that you've taken? And I think that's the basis of my question, because these are family court judges.
We have sufficient staff for the new family court judges. Yes, we do.
Thank you, Judge. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Next, Mr. Graff, Assemblyman Graff.
Hi, Judge. How are you?
Good morning.
Now, you have one program where, at arraignments, everyone gets assigned an attorney, right? And even if the person's making $200,000, $300,000, or no matter what he makes, right, they get assigned an attorney at arraignment. How much is that costing us?
People making $200,000, $300,000 a year are getting attorneys at arraignments. I can't tell you that's never happened, but I can honestly say I don't believe that's a major problem.
Well, that's what's happening. Suffolk County, they have assigned attorneys, okay, that sit in the courtroom. And if somebody doesn't have an attorney, and it doesn't matter what they make, for arraignment, they're getting an attorney.
Yeah, I think that attorneys staff the arraignment parts in places like Suffolk County. And, you know, the courts are under a very strict mandate from the Court of Appeals that people have to be arraigned within 24 hours of their arrest. So if someone is arrested, is brought by the police to the courthouse, is brought to the courtroom to be arraigned, and there's a lawyer assigned to that arraignment part, yes, that could happen, that somebody who otherwise could afford a lawyer would have the services of that lawyer for the very brief arraignment proceeding, but would not receive a free lawyer for the pendency of the case.
If I can, Judge. You have legal aid assigned to the courtroom, but there are income requirements, all right? So anyone that doesn't meet the income requirement in Suffolk County, right, who cannot be assigned legal aid is being assigned almost like an 18B attorney, all right? Even if they're making $200,000 a year, if they're being arraigned, that money, and I'm looking, could be better used, all right, to staff court personnel. Because let me explain what's happening. It takes me, in Suffolk County and District Court, up to 3.5 years to get a hearing. I just did a trial on a misdemeanor. It took me 5 years to get a jury trial. And what's happening is, we've come to a point where we've cut the court staff so much in an attempt to save money that it's actually costing us money. So what's happening in Suffolk County, and I don't know about the rest of the state because that's mainly where I practice, is if somebody has to be taken into custody, the entire courtroom shuts down. That slows down the entire process, right, and leads to court congestion. There are times where they have to bring a person from custody up to the courtroom. That takes forever because they have limited personnel to bring that person to the courtroom. There have been times in Suffolk County where you have an individual who's in custody and it's so hard to get that person into the courtroom that where there would have been a disposition in the case and that person would have been released that day, they wind up getting adjourned for 2 weeks, so they spend more time in custody. So what I'm saying to you, and I'm just looking at all the things that you've been forced to do because of budget constraints. And I'm saying we need more money for court officers. We need more money for court clerks. Because we're at a crisis point where the safety of the personnel in the courtroom are in jeopardy. The safety of the people appearing in the court is now in jeopardy because of lack of court officers. The courtrooms are not functioning properly because of the lack of personnel. And I mean, you have gotten creative, and I'm not blaming the judges, I'm not blaming the administration, I'm blaming us for not looking at the problems here and identifying these problems and making sure that we're not stepping over a dollar to pick up a dime, which is what I think we're doing here. You've seen the slowdowns in the courtroom. You know, you watch the calendars. So, I mean, do you agree with the fact that we've gotten to the point where it's actually costing us money because it's slowing down the process?
Yeah, no, I think there are delays in cases throughout the court system. But I have to tell you, if it's taking 5 years to get a misdemeanor trial in Suffolk County, that is absolutely unconscionable. And I will, I can promise you I will look into that today, afternoon, because that's unconscionable.
And Judge, half the other problem, if you want to relieve the congestion, is the 30-30 statute doesn't exist in New York State, okay? Because all we get is it's always court time. It's always court time. That's nonsense. They're denying clients' rights to a speedy trial. And I look at the appellate, you know, decisions, and never is there a decision on 30-30 for the most part.
I agree with you. It's a misnomer. It's never been an effective speedy trial statute. It is not effective in moving cases to trial. I agree with you completely on that.
Well, year after year, I keep saying that we have to do something with this. You know, it's nonsense when I sit there, and I've been in front of judges, and I'm ready for trial. I'm ready for a hearing. And the judge goes, well, we can't do a trial today. I said, well, send me to another courtroom, okay? And I get court time. And then if I do an appeal, it's never decided on 30-30. So basically, we're ignoring the Constitution in the state of New York, and that's causing court congestion. So, I mean, I have a lot of problems with what's going on in our courtrooms, especially with the staffing requirements, all right? I do think that we're stepping over a dollar to pick up a dime here. And by not funding, especially correctional officers and clerks and everything else, right, it's actually costing us money. The last thing is the recording devices that we have for transcripts. It's not the same as a person that is actually taking it down, a court reporter. Because when we get that back, there's nothing but errors and everything else and the time period. So I would say, you know, we need to fund court personnel. Because if you really want to save money, we need to hire more court personnel.
Okay, I agree with you.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Senator Dan Squadron.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair and committee. It's good timing, and I want to pick up right where Assemblymember Graff left off with, I think he referred to it as a non-existent 3030 statute. In fact, might be better off with none than with this. The current 3030 statute was written in order to keep the federal government from coming into New York State in the early 70s, signed by Governor Rockefeller in contradiction to a report from the court on how to actually fix our speedy trial statute at a time when court congestion wasn't as bad as it is today. I appreciate your testimony. I understand that the Commission on Judicial Pay ties your hands a little bit, but I do want to say when we have the kind of delay and backup that we see, when we have the kind of violation of the accused constitutional rights, the kind of cost and pain suffered by victims from the sort of court delay that we have, I really urge, and I've done the same thing to the incoming chief judge, an aggressive look at a crisis of court delay, a crisis of constitutional rights to a speedy trial being absolutely ignored in New York State. In fact, the statute to protect them is used to damage them. In my home borough of Brooklyn, we're up 26% on court delays in 2015. In 2013, in New York City, 594 days citywide, mean age of disposition. 594 is almost 2 years. 732 days in the Bronx. 2012, 55% of felony cases in New York City were pending for more than 6 months. That is a crisis. In fact, the Advisory Committee on Criminal Law and Procedure gave a report to you last year that said most would agree, as you have already, which I really appreciate, that 3030 has been largely unsuccessful in moving criminal trials in an expeditious fashion. It also says the problem is more than just a lack of sufficient judicial resources. It also involves a willingness to go to trial. You said in response to Senator Hassel-Thompson that people are sitting in jail because they can't make bail. I would amend that. They're sitting in jail because they can't make bail and because of the kind of court delays we have. I carry a bill to fix this, named for Khalif Browder, who spent more than 1,000 days in jail before having his case dismissed, tragically committed suicide last year. What's the solution? How are we going to do it together this year?
I think these are all real problems that you've discussed, and the solution is, and I think the new chief judge is very interested in this problem, and I think you'll be hearing more from her shortly about this, but I think she wants to address and focus her attention on this, and this has to be a priority. It will be a priority. But I think the ultimate solution, the criminal justice system has many components, and obviously the court system is a central component within the criminal justice system. But to eliminate some of these problems, address these delays, streamline the process, we have to work together with the other components of the criminal justice system. There's a lot that we can do ourselves, that the judiciary can do, but we can't do it all, and we need to work with law enforcement, with the defense bar, with the institutional criminal defense providers, with probation departments. I mean, we need to work together with all the components of the criminal justice system to solve these problems. That's the only way to do it.
And just explain to me the role of the court system, and then the role of the other partners you just described.
In the role that what?
Of the partners you just described.
We have a major role, maybe the critical role. Right. And
what is that role, just sort of more specifically?
Well, in the end, it's the judge that can move the case to trial. I mean, the parties have to be ready, but if there's delay or lack of readiness, if there are excuses, in the end, it's the judge that has to ensure that there's a quick resolution, an expeditious resolution of the case. So first and foremost, and ultimately, the responsibility is with the court system and with judges.
Let me just ask this question directly. If court congestion didn't stop the clock, wouldn't that move trials a lot more quickly?
If court congestion
wasn't a reason to stop the speedy trial clock, wouldn't that move trials much more quickly?
Absolutely.
Is that something you support?
Is that what?
Something you support, allowing the clock to run for the entire time between trial or hearing dates, even if it's court congestion that's leading to the delay?
You mean if court congestion was the reason for the delay?
The prosecutor asks for a week and gets a date 3 weeks hence. Is that 7 days or is that 21 days?
Under the speedy trial statute?
Currently it's seven. If it were 21, I think that would be the beginning of solving this problem. I'm asking, is that something that the court system would support?
Look, a more effective speedy trial statute could make a great contribution to eliminating delays in criminal cases, no question.
And so it sounds like you also agree that we don't need more money before we talk about fixing speedy trial. We should fix 30-30, and then next year we'll talk about the money that we need to make that work. Is that the right order of operations?
I think there are a lot of things we can do without more money.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
We have been joined by Senator Valmonette Montgomery.
We've also been joined by Assemblywoman Dupree.
Any questions on this side? Oh, Danny O'Donnell.
Well, it's been a rough morning for me, Judge.
It's part of the job.
Senator Nozzolio suggested $100 million for legal services. I almost passed out, and I agree with Al Graff, so that's really quite a warning for me. I had chosen not to speak because I would like to go home sometime in my lifetime today. So, but there's a couple of things I want to raise. One is I want to say that I 100% agree with Senator Squadron. And just so you know, I was a full-time public defender from 1987 to 1995. And at the beginning of that time, if a DA came into the courtroom and said, Your Honor, my key witness is in Florida and I'll be ready tomorrow, and the case was adjourned for a month, the judge charged that whole month to the people on the running of the clock. So now there's an absolute manipulation of that where they say, but I'll be ready tomorrow. And then they adjourn the case for 2 months and only charge one day to the people. With all due respect, sir, that's the judge's fault. The judge doesn't have to do that. The judge could say, well, you're not ready today, you're not ready. And in the time that I worked there, it went from when you could expect some attempt to try a case within the speedy trial limits to a point where it could never, ever happen, which leads me to my statement about bail. We have too many people in jail awaiting trial on bail. So isn't it true a judge is allowed to take into consideration in setting the bail the nature of the crime?
Yes.
Aren't they allowed to take into consideration the facts that they're aware of about the crime?
Yes.
Aren't they allowed to take into effect any history of coming or not coming to court?
Absolutely.
Aren't they allowed to take into effect family ties, community ties, and other things determined by the criminal justice system?
See, you've read the statute recently.
I haven't. I'm just pretty smart about this. So my question for you is, how many people are you aware of that have been accused of murder, who've never been accused before, who get released on bail? I would like someone on the minions that work for you to tell me what the answer to that question is, because the answer, in my opinion, is almost nobody, except if you're white and rich, but that's not your fault. Almost no one. So if, in fact, almost no one is released when they're charged with murder, then what that means is, in effect, the system is taking into account what the risk might be to society to let them out. And we don't need to change the bail statute to give more people reasons to keep more people in jail. We need to change the bail statute so that we're not having people sit in places like Rikers Island for years, years, before they can assert their constitutional right to the presumption of innocence. And I think the judiciary needs to take a better role and look at this and not advocate for changing it to make the bail statute even harder on people who don't have resources. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Liz Krueger.
Thank you. I also wasn't planning to ask too many questions because so many of us are here today. But just going back to civil legal services, even though there has been the growth in money available, can you tell me how many people have to go to a court situation without an attorney in the civil system?
Yeah, it's still about, although there's been great improvement with that problem, there's still a great majority of the people in civil cases who can't afford a lawyer still don't have a lawyer. It's as much as 70%.
And someone gave me the number that we were at 2.3 million cases without attorneys and we're down to 1.8 million. Does that seem a realistic number to you, the number of people who don't have attorneys for civil cases?
I know it's very difficult to kind of document this, but I think that sounds correct, if I recall. I know that the estimates are that over the last 5-6 years, the percentage of people in civil cases who can't afford an attorney, who have an attorney, has gone from 20% to 30%, which is actually a 50% increase, if my math is correct. But obviously, that still leaves the great majority of people without a lawyer. So it's an ongoing problem. This additional money has made an enormous difference in the lives of the people who do have lawyers because of it, and it's hundreds of thousands of cases a year where people now have lawyers because of this money, but it's a gargantuan problem, no question.
I represent a part of Manhattan Island. I certainly can verify that the difficulty in finding somebody representation in endless numbers of civil cases for disproportionately the elderly, the disabled, tenants. And again, the biggest issue I see in the problems here are that in a civil case where it's not you versus the government, it's you against someone, the someone else always has an attorney. And so the unfairness of going through the court process to me seems fairly extreme. So, for the record, we can't support reducing funding for civil legal services. We have to continue our commitment that was a multi-year commitment to expanding funds for civil legal services. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator.
No. Assemblywoman People Stokes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Judge, I appreciated hearing all your comments today, and I actually appreciated hearing the questions and responses from my colleagues. But I just have one really quick point I want to raise, and hopefully you're able to give me that number today. If not, I can look forward to receiving it soon. What is the total number of staff on the Office of Court Administrations? And what is the total number of counsel on civil legal services? And what are the diversity numbers there?
I'm sorry, I don't have that with me, but I'll absolutely get you that those numbers. We have them, and we'll get them to you.
The numbers and the diversity.
Yes.
Thank you. Senator Marty Golden.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I do believe judges should have the discretion to set bail and the ability of the defendant to return to court and also set the risk assessment at the violence, and I think you're doing an outstanding job. And I do believe that we have to help you correct the imbalance in this system and putting more dollars made available so we can have more judges and more employees to be able to move these cases through the system. real quick question. I'm also the chair of the public employees, and I had them up in my office about a month ago, and I thought I heard 14% they're down, and that's different from the number that you've given. The court offices across the state of New York are 14% off from where they were since 2009.
Could you repeat that? I'm sorry.
The number of court offices presently are down 14% from the number of 2009 that I have.
It's 6%, but depending on who came to you, they might have been talking about a particular court or type of court.
No, it was statewide.
Statewide, it's 6%. You know, I'll show you the numbers.
If you could get those numbers for me, I'd appreciate it. Thank you, Ilana. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator.
That's it.
Okay. Senator Valmanette Montgomery.
Do you hear me?
Thank you, Madam Chair.
2 hours.
Judge, good morning.
Good morning.
I just have one question that I would like to ask. You are familiar with the Center for Court Innovation?
Yes.
And one of the issues, or one of the sort of experimental, if you will, I guess we can say, courts that they have come up with and that have been actually put into action by under the auspices of Chief Justices Kay and Lipman, and I hope that we're looking to make that a permanent and central part of our court system, and that is the youth courts. I don't understand, and I don't know how you view that. It has worked so beautifully in one of the community courts in my district, and all of the information that I have in those areas, other than the Red Hook Youth Court, which is in my district, have really benefited young people extremely well. It's also an opportunity to teach young people how the system works, to give them an opportunity to develop some skill and some understanding of the system, because they play the roles of all of the different components of the court. And so it keeps young people out of the system, but it also acts as an extremely important leadership development program. So I'm wondering what you think about it, and if we can look forward to continuing to support that court and make it more central to what we do as it relates to young people in our state.
Yeah, the youth courts are terrific, and you know, we have them in Brooklyn, we have them in places all over the state. They're supported by the district attorney's offices where we have them, and they're a terrific idea. You find them in other states around the country, not just New York, and we're totally committed to continuing to support them.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Michael Nozzolio.
Thank you again, Madam Chair. Judge, coming to the issue of bail, that Judge Lipman drafted a bill, but because Judge Lipman is not a member of the legislature, I, as chair of the Codes Committee, as a professional courtesy, introduced his legislation. It's been pending before the Codes Committee for a number of months, and that I'd like to have your reaction to a comment made that says the reform of the so-called broken jail system, Judge Lipman's bill, insults judges, overlooks that bail review is available presently, fails to provide a complete record of bail release decisions, and intrudes on the judiciary's independence. Now, that's not by a member of the legislature. That's by a co-Supreme Court judge, Judge McLaughlin, in the city of New York, who indicated that these provisions would establish what he called a two-tier system of justice where you'd see an automatic judicial review triggered when a defendant is unable to make bail. Now, that means, to me, that we'd have 50,000 appeals automatically. And you were talking about clogging the system earlier, the demands on the budget. Certainly, I know those have to be weighed. We're seeking justice here. But from a logistical standpoint, and I think it'd be very fair for you to be able to comment publicly on Judge McLaughlin's public opposition to the legislation.
Well, I have to say I strongly disagree with that assessment of that program. 50,000 cases, that's just not true. It's a misdemeanor program. It takes advantage of an existing statutory provision in the law which gives a Supreme Court judge de novo review authority on the application of a defendant to conduct a de novo review, a full review of a lower court's bail ruling. We've simply set up a part in Supreme Court to allow for that if the defendant makes an application to have the case calendared in the Supreme Court part. It's not a lot of cases. It's limited to low-level cases. It's not insulting to judges at all. Judges, bail is set in the arraignment parts where the volume is enormous. There's strict constitutional and statutory time limits on how quickly cases have to be arraigned. In the arraignment part, it quickly follows the arrest. The defense lawyer doesn't really know much about the defendant at that point. The prosecutor doesn't know much about the defendant. The judge certainly doesn't know much about the defendant. And the process that was put in place was merely to give an option to the defendant to make an application later on to a Supreme Court judge where there'll be more time to evaluate the case. There'll be more information at that point. And there's nothing insulting to judges about this at all. It's a fairer process that's been put in place that's entirely consistent with what the law now authorizes.
Judge McLaughlin felt pretty insulted by this, and I certainly opinion differs, and that we'll look to you for further explanation of this from your advantage as a judge experience. It seems as though, just on its surface, that any defense counsel would be tiptoeing around malpractice if they didn't seek an automatic appeal under this provision. And to me, that begs the question, in the real world, wouldn't they be doubly encouraged to pursue extrajudicial review?